We're not against rap. We're not against rappers. But we are against those.
Something big about to happen. I hear the beat tapping.
We some fly rhyming felines rapping on the track. Better yet, grab a gat, cause we hot like.
Enzo, doors closed, windows up, cause that's the way we like to ride. Windy City hitting.
Check mic 1, 2, 1, 2. We live, baby.
Hey, Chicago, and welcome back to Speak Your Mind Radio. I'm your hostess with the mostest, Queen Star, a.k.a. Miss Hip Hop. And today we have a really, really cool guest with us today. You know, she's not your average Joe. She is from Chicago and has been a great friend, sister, and mother who I get my many talents from. So, you know, now that you know, bringing up next to the mic, MaMa Crystal.
MaMa Crystal. Ma, just call me Ma.
Okay, Ma. Well, here on Speak Your Mind Radio, we start off each and every show with the icebreaker question for the guests. So let's hop to it.
Oh, God. I hope it's not going to be a question that I don't know the answer to, but okay.
Okay. Well, who is the most influential artist that you listen to?
That I listen to or that I consider to, can it be more than one artist?
Yeah.
Okay. I think Sade is very influential. I love her music. I love her flow. I love how she can be provocative, sexy, and still be a lady at the same time on stage without stripping.
I agree.
Another influential artist I would have to say is Sting. I love their music. I love Sting's music. One in particular called It's Probably Me.
Oh.
And Gregory Porter, he's a jazz musician, a jazz singer. He sings that song with so much of soul. It even brings Sting to tears.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's a powerful message, and that's that particular recording as well as Probably Me. You have to listen to it sometime.
Well, I listened to it a couple of times. I do remember asking you before, you know, kind of like what your music interests were. And Gregory Porter, yeah, he is a jazz musician, a black artist, and yes. Sting is a great band, a legendary band. Mm-hmm. So to bring those two artists together, it's like a little treat.
Yes. But,
that's pretty
and,
cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, you know, and of course, you know, Prince and Michael Jackson.
So what's the message behind It's Probably Me, that song? Because maybe I got a different interpretation than you did.
Okay, well, first of all, Sting wrote that song. He had a friend who was one of the writers for the movie with Danny Glover and Danny Glover and I can't remember his name. But they were a duo. Mm-hmm. There were two cops in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Give me 5 seconds because I know I can come up.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Lethal Weapon.
Okay.
Yes. So it was the movie Lethal Weapon. And Sting had a friend who was a writer on the show.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Lethal Weapon was Danny Glover and Mel Gibson.
Mm-hmm.
And his friend called him and said, hey, you know, we need a lead-in song. you know, a song for this, for the second part of Lethal Weapon. We need a song for it. And he says, oh, yeah, but what do you want me to do about that? He says, listen, I really need some help here. And it's about these two cops, and they start out hating each other, but they have a bromance relationship. And so that's what the song is about. It's about two friends having, one friend is having the other one's back all the time, mm-hmm. No matter what. And, you know, he says, it's probably me who's going to be the one to save you. He said, I hate to say it. No, I don't want to say it, but it's probably going to be me.
Right.
And so that's a powerful message in that song for me, because he tells his friend, you know, you're too proud to beg, and, you know, you're too proud to steal if you're hungry. And if anybody's going to lay down their life for you, you know, because you're not the most likable guy anyway. So it's going to be me.
Right. It's like the relationship. Yeah.
Well, we do this all the time with each other. Even with the texting, you go first.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's probably just kind of like the relationship that you have with yourself. Like, you know, you're going to be your own friend.
Well, and even beyond that, it's nice to have a relationship like that outside of yourself. Somebody who can catch you when you fall.
That's true.
You know, somebody who can help pull you up by the bootstrap. Somebody who knows that, you know what, you're not really a likable person, but I know you, mm-hmm. and I like you, and I got you.
That is so true.
Yeah. So, yeah, very powerful meaning. I love that song. And, of course, Roxanne.
Oh, okay. Roxanne by Sting?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Uh-huh. So, yeah, that's a classic song.
Yes, yes. And so those are my favorites. And, of course, the legendary Tina Turner.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Those are, you know, some of my influential artists.
Okay. So why don't you tell everybody, like, what part of Chicago you're from and how that shaped who you are today?
Oh, I grew up on the south side of Chicago. I'm not so sure if it shaped me one way or the other. It's just, you know, you deal with things as they come about, you know, and whatever cards you're dealt in life, that's what you do. And so it wasn't a terrible upbringing, because I grew up in the south side of Chicago in the 70s and the 80s. So it was a lot different than what it is now. You know, it wasn't, the gang violence wasn't as notorious as it is now, because the gangs then had rules and guidelines, and, you know, they set rules and you could not break those rules, where now the gangs don't have any rules.
Right.
So I don't think it really shaped me or misshaped me in any shape, form, or fashion. One thing I can say, you knew which areas you could go into.
Mm-hmm.
Safe areas or unsafe areas for Blacks. Not so much gang-related things, but because of your race, you knew certain areas you could go to and certain areas you could not go to without it being a conflict.
Yeah, that's very true. Yeah, Chicago is just a different place to grow up in. Mm-hmm. Especially the inner city of Chicago.
Right. Right.
So
a beautiful place at the same time.
Yeah, it's definitely a beautiful place. I think people from Chicago have great hearts after you scratch beyond the surface. Mm-hmm. You know?
Mm-hmm. Beautiful architect and, you know, beautiful museums. And it's, you know, it has a lot to offer. You just have to be able to navigate yourself through things.
That's true. Mm-hmm. So I know a lot of people are wondering why I brought you on the show today. And so I'm going to tell you all this. I brought my mom on the show because, you know, how you want to make your parents proud of you and, you know, work, and you often ask yourself, oh, I wonder what they think. Well, that's why I brought her on the show. So, Mom, What is your favorite episode from me?
Oh, wow. There are a few. I hope I can get their names right. Descendant.
Mm-hmm.
Ola.
Mm-hmm.
Descendant Ola. Queen Who.
Mm-hmm.
Estelle.
Yep.
Bianca Shaw.
Mm-hmm.
The film directors.
Matthias Saunders. Yeah. Yeah.
And then there was one more. Oh, the group. Catching me off guard here. The group that just did the protests. Those three young men.
The masterminds?
Yes.
Yeah.
Masterminds.
Yeah.
Those are just a few of my favorite. And of course, the one you did about me for Mother's Day, and I was so upset with you.
Yeah, I know.
So upset with you for putting me out there. But when I listened to it, I was very touched.
Yeah.
I realized there was nothing to be upset about.
Of course not. I was just trying to get the truth out there.
Yes. And you did. You did a good job. And so, yeah, I'm very proud of you. I'm very proud of you because this is something that I knew that you were destined to do.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. And the fact that you named your show Speak Your Mind, and it's funny how it interconnects with who you were, who you are, who you will be anyway, because you've always spoken your mind,
right?
You know, even as a child you always did so. It's not surprising that you're doing what you're doing and that you will eventually rise above what you're doing.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. A lot of people ask, like, how did you come up with the name for your podcast? And I'm like, even if you look at the trailer for the podcast, it's not nothing like a preview to what it's like today, and it's even still changing from that point. Mm-hmm. I thought I would just be talking about social media issues and, you know, bringing people on the show who wanted to voice their opinion about the things that were going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's still like that. Everybody that comes on the show have something to say. So I got the name Speak Your Mind. One day I was traveling, you know, on a train in Chicago, and there was this guy in the box train, and he was like, where'd you get that jacket from? And my jacket, it was a leather jacket that said Speak Your Mind. And I said, oh, I just, you know, bought it or whatever. He said, oh, it looked like you made it. And I'm like, no, I didn't make it. And he was like, oh, you should think, you know, consider having, you know, making a fashion line that says Speak Your Mind, like shirts and stuff.
Mm.
And I never forgot that he said that, because it was one of my favorite jackets. I still have it till today.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I just remember that. So that was 3 years ago. And I'm like, yeah, that's the name of the podcast, Speak Your Mind, with Y-O instead of your.
Right. And make isn't that funny how things just kind of swirl around us all of our lives, and then we go back and we, you know, kind of like pick up where our existence began. You've always spoken your mind as a little girl, you know, and then you meet someone based on a jacket that you had on.
Right.
And they say the same thing about, hey, why don't you do something, you know, with this logo?
Right.
And right. So the logo wasn't to go on clothing for, I mean, maybe it is to go on clothing, but not through you manufacturing it at that particular time. But look how you have manufactured that, that logo within your podcast, within your social media So it's just how we're all interconnected.
Yeah, I was actually going to review an album by the late and great Mac Miller. He died over an accidental drug overdose too. So just like Juice WRLD. Mm-hmm. And his last album that he put out was called Circles. And I don't know what it is about these rappers, these young rappers, especially when they die. It's almost like they knew they were going to die. And it says it, like, you can hear it in the last albums. Mm-hmm. So Circles, just like the title, it means life is a circle. It really is. And one of the ways life is a circle, like you said, you pick up things that you thought you were done with, or you started but didn't quite finish. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So one circle of life is growing older from a child to an adult, and then you have a child, and guess what? You have to start over the process of growing up all over again, because now you have to teach them
right
what you've learned when as you grew older.
Right.
Make sure they don't fall in those same pitfalls that you did.
Exactly.
And that's the circle of life, but it also goes beyond that too. That's just scratching the surface, because, okay, whether you have kids or not, you're going to see that being a circle of life.
Absolutely.
The other circle is maybe starting some. Yeah. Okay. So I'll just go use myself an example. I did start speaking my mind at a very young age, and I always got in trouble for it in grammar school, grade school. Always. You were always up there talking to my teachers. Like, she won't shut up. And then don't tell me to shut up, because I will tell you to shut up as a child to an adult.
right.
So.
Oh, yeah. I remember well when I had to leave my job because the principal called me.
Exactly. See? Always up
because
there.
Of that mouth.
Yep.
Mouth wasn't disrespectful.
It wasn't.
You had corrected one of your teachers with the history the history topic, and she was very forceful, aggressive in teaching the wrong side of history to her sixth grade, or was it fifth grade students?
Yeah.
And you stood up, you rose your hand, and you said, well, no, that's not true. And you were able to give her the reasons that it was not true. Mm-hmm. And it contradicted what she was saying. And she got very angry and sent you out the room to the principal's office, and the principal called me. It was really something. And so came up there, we met with the principal and the teacher. And I think the topic at the time was, she was teaching that Egypt mm-hmm. was not in Africa. Mm-hmm. I think that's what she was teaching, wasn't it?
Yes.
And the Egyptians were not black people. Mm-hmm. We knew Egyptians were not African-American people. Mm-hmm. But she was saying that the color of their skin wasn't black. She was really all into it. So I had to come up, have a meeting with the principal, you, me, the principal, the teacher, and I think they called in a social worker.
Oh, God.
To sit in on the meeting. But the long story short was that everybody got a chance to speak their mind.
Right.
Including you.
Right.
Because I wanted you to be a part. They wanted you to sit outside, and I said, no, I'm here because of her. So she needs to be a part of this meeting.
Right.
So she can tell her side. And that's what happened. And the principal ultimately agreed with you.
Yeah, because I was sitting in class and she was teaching that. And right. I turned around out my seat and said, that's not true.
Right.
The Egyptians were black. And she looked at me and she didn't like what I had to say.
Right.
And she said, because she's going by the book.
Right.
So when she told me I was wrong, and she, if you know, I'm a kid, so I was like, okay, this adult is not listening to me, so why should I listen to her? Mm-hmm. I turned back around in my seat and started talking. And she got so angry at me because I just turned around and started talking. I know she didn't like that. So she came from behind me, grabbed me by my shoulders, and turned me around to look at her. She said, "Perry, be quiet."
Oh my God.
So mad at her. Then that's how I came up to the school. So
yeah, that's why I came up to the school. And that's funny. All these years, we're still talking about that. But that's, you know, even before then, but, you know, in public, that's what you did. And you were never disrespectful with it, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, adults don't like to hear children. They believe that old adage, the children are to be seen and not heard.
Right.
And I was just the opposite. I want to hear what the children are saying.
Me too.
I want to hear what their thoughts are. Because we learn from kids too. We just have to sit down and shut up and listen.
Yeah, that's why as children, it's hard raising our parents. So, so you know, I understand.
Yes, I know. I'm getting to that point that I need.
Oh, you need help
raising.
Right, you need help too.
Yes, because I don't know at all. I'm still trying to figure this thing out.
Yeah, because life is so much different than it was when you grew up in the 70s and 80s. So,
yeah, and we thought we had it hard then. You know, every generation thinks that they have it hard. You know, but I think my generation, I would be like the end of the baby boomers.
Right.
I think it stopped at 1964.
Oh, wow.
So I would be on the tail end. I think it started like in 45 or 1950 to 64. So I would be on the tail end of the baby boomers.
Boomers.
And so I think that generation was the last generation to be the generation that that the older adults would, hey, see you swinging on a tree outside that was in front of your house, and you're one of those trees that the city had planted, and you're swinging on it. They would come out and reprimand you, and then tell your parents on you as well.
Exactly. But now it's like,
right?
They don't say anything to these young whippersnappers because they're gonna snap you up.
That's right.
You know, it's just dangerous these days. But it's also a big line between, you know, you being an adult as you are at your age and me being an adult as me as my age. I see the difference that these younger people than me, the 20-year-olds, have with the relationships they have with their generational parents and grandparents, and then us too. Mm-hmm. And we see stuff because I really connect to young people for some reason, like really, really connect with them. And I'm like an old school young person, if that makes sense. So it's just like when they tell me certain things, I'm able to say, oh, well, no, it's really this. And but we still connect though, you know?
Yeah, because you're your generation, you're the millennials.
Right.
Or the generation Y that they used to say that changed it to the millennials. You guys were born between the early 80s and the late 90s.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, that makes sense.
Yeah, so you guys are the millennials. And then there was a generation before you, and they were the Generation X or Gen X.
Right.
And
right.
That would be where your sister falls into that category.
Right.
They were born between mid-60s and early 80s.
Right.
So, you know, they're between 41 and 55 years old. So she would fit into that generation.
That's so true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When I was a kid, did you see that I had a what do you call it? An older spirit, or what kind of spirit did I have as a child?
As a child, you had a discerning.
Yeah, I did.
Spirit. You know, you were just one of those kids that were able to see maybe something that an adult an average adult would not necessarily see. And again, that, you know, we have a lot of distractions. And so coming up as a kid, you didn't have as many distractions as a kid would have today. So you were able to really tap into not knowing what it was, you know, mm-hmm. not understanding what it was, but you knew it was something. For example, I remember you might have been about 3-4 at the most. You and I and your sister decided to go to this neighborhood church. I don't know if you remember this, mm-hmm. but we went to a neighborhood church, and it was just the three of us. I had never gone there before, and I decided this Sunday morning, hey, let's walk up to this church and see what it's about, because I don't think I had a car there. So we walked up to the church, and as soon as we opened the door and crossed the threshold, you started this screaming that it was like a blood-curdling scream. Mm. And we're walking down the middle of the aisle, and you're squeezing my hand, and you're screaming, and tears are just streaming down your face. It was almost, no, not almost, it was quite embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know what was wrong with you, so I bent down to pick you up, and you're screaming still in my ear. And you're saying, get me out of here. And I'm like, what the hell? You know, and I just turned around. It was so embarrassing. Mm-hmm. So the three of us walked back out with you in my arms. As soon as we crossed the threshold, you stopped.
Mm-hmm.
No hyperventilating in between, no sniffling, no nothing, none of that. You just immediately stopped.
Mm-hmm.
And I put you down, and I looked at you. I said, are you all right? And you said, yeah, can we go home now? And I was baffled by that. Mm-hmm. You were like 3-4 years old, and I didn't have the words then to ask you what was going on. I didn't, you know, I said, are you okay? You said, yes. Can we go home now? And for you, that was the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, it was like, what the hell is going on here? And then you did that another time. You may have been around that same age, between 4 and 5, and we were standing at a bus stop. It was in the evening, about 7, sun. It was about dusk dawn, and I was standing there. And I'm waiting for the bus, and you're standing next to me, and you reach up and you say, Mama, pick me up. And I said, no, you have to stay, because I have this bag in my hand and I'm tired. So waiting on the bus, you said, no, Mama, pick me up now. So I obeyed reluctantly, and I picked you up, and you whispered in my ear. And you said, there's a man coming. We need to move away. And I said, what man? Move away? Where? Move away to where? And you said, there's a man coming. He's coming now. We have to move away. He's a bad man. And when I looked up again, there was a man coming down the street. He had to be about 30 feet away.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay, well, where are we going to move to? You said, we just have to move away. So there was a restaurant, a Church's Chicken to be exact, about 5 to 8 feet away from us. So we moved up to the Church's Chicken, praying that we don't miss our bus. And the man finally gets to the bus stop where we were standing. And he stood there and he looked around like spun around in a circle, like he was looking for something. Mm-hmm. And he did look up at the restaurant, and then he proceeded. He kept going again. And I asked you, I said, can we go back out now? You go, yeah, it's safe now. So again, you had forgotten about everything, and I'm still left wondering what the hell is going on with this kid. And so just different occasions, those two really pop up in my head. So you've always been that, had that intuitive spirit about yourself.
That's true. I've always had a discerning spirit because I can even piggyback that those two incidents when I was 3 and 4 years old to when I was about 20 something years old. Now, me and my girlfriend, we were supposed to go to this nightclub in the inner city of Chicago. Now I'm telling you, it's bad, you know, and I'm looking at the area in which it's at, and I'm like, I don't think we should go in here. She's like, oh, we drove all this way. Da, 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 da. I'm like, dang, she's right. We did drive all this way. But I'm like super scared because I'm just sensing something's not right. Mm-hmm. So we go park in this parking lot. And now granted, here's my second confirmation that something wasn't right. There was this guy trying to ask for $10 to park into a parking space or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I guess he was a homeless man, and then he was like, then he finally said, well, don't go in there. Y'all shouldn't be going in there. And then of course, you know, we just ignore him because, well, he probably don't know what he's talking about. He probably drunk or something, but I took it as a sign too, mm-hmm. because I was already feeling like that. Mm-hmm. And so I told her, and this was dangerous too. I said, I'm not going in there. I'm sitting right here. I said, I'm not going anywhere. And so she got mad. She got out the car, locked the doors, and she took her behind in there. And little did she know, but I knew, she would be running her ass back out in 5 minutes because they started shooting in the nightclub and everybody ran out.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, see, I told you. And I'm like looking crazy at this point, but it happened though.
Mm-hmm. Now, what I'm going to take a stab in the dark here.
Yeah.
And say this friend who you were with that day.
Yeah.
That evening. Would that have happened to be Miss Donyetta?
Yeah, it is. Every time I talk about her, she listens. She's like, I know you were talking about me. I'm like, yeah, I was.
Oh, yeah. You guys were partners in crime.
Weren't
we? In mm-hmm. every sense of the word.
Yeah, we really were. We really, really were. And I just tried everything in my might to get her not to go inside that nightclub. Everything.
Yeah, I can see her doing that.
And so that comes back to the circle of life again, because now, listen, although we were supposed together, we were supposed to go in that nightclub. We were going to see one of our favorite performers. Mm-hmm. His name is Twista. He's from Chicago. He's a rapper. Was mm-hmm. Twista and Shauna, matter of fact. And we didn't get a chance to see them because they started, like I said, shooting. Mm-hmm. So years and years and years later, I ended up going to a Twista concert and I ended up seeing Shauna. I ended up seeing Twista. Mm-hmm. And I started taking footage, put it on my Instagram. They both liked it. Mm-hmm. So that was full circle. Like, well, you didn't get a chance to see us in that year, but you saw us this time and you got our attention.
That is so true. That is full circle. how things happen the way they do. Everything is so interconnected. People, situations, circumstances, bad things that happen, good things that happen, things that happen that we're trying to figure out. Well, what was that all about?
Yeah.
And then you find out maybe a day or two later, or a year or two later, or even. Maybe even a decade later.
It's definitely, the more interconnected you are with the universe, the less time those things take to reoccur and come back full circle again.
I agree.
Because you're on the right course. Your stars are aligned.
Yes. And that's very important. Because when we talk about the universe, I always say, you know, people have different explanations or definitions or understanding of what they feel like their higher power is, or mm-hmm. what the higher power is, or their God or their savior, mm-hmm. or, you know, their spirituality. People have different ways of expressing, you know, their experiences. And so I personally think that the universe governs us, you know, through
That's
so
true.
Many, yeah, through so many different, there's so many laws of the universe.
Yes.
One that we are very much aware of is the law of cause and effect. And simply put, that's just saying everything comes full circle. What goes around comes back around.
Yes. What you put out there is what you will get back.
What you will get back, you know? Mm-hmm. Right. And so it's not up to us to say how we're going to get it back, though. But we do get it back. Even when you have someone that says, you know, sometimes we'll look at a person from the outside and we'll say, you know what? They're really a great person. Mm-hmm. They're really a good person. They don't deserve to be treated a certain way, or they didn't deserve that, you know? And we can really believe that because that is really the truth. And then if you look at it from another perspective and say, you know what? Now, how long has he allowed himself to be treated this way?
Yeah, that's true.
Cause and effect. How long has he or she allowed themselves to be treated in this manner, to be treated unfairly, to go through the same pattern over and over and over again? How long have you allowed this to happen to yourself? That's, again, a law of cause and effect. What goes around comes back around. And if you continue to allow yourself to be trampled upon, manipulated, not treated well, you may be a part of that effect. You may be a part of that because at some point you should have been able to say, you know what, enough is enough.
Mm-hmm.
Let me change this course of direction. Go ahead.
Yeah, right. You got to be the one to change that because you can have that perception of a person being, oh, this is a great person. They're phenomenal.
Right.
But why is this certain situation reoccurring and happening to them right now? Oh, let me try to intervene and help. But the laws of the universe say maybe you're not supposed to intervene and help. Maybe this is the last lingering essence of their karma. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Maybe they're just learning their self-worth and they really got to learn it by themselves. It's like a chick breaking through the egg. You can't help the chick break through the egg because it's going to die. They have to break through it themselves. Or a butterfly, a caterpillar that's transforming into a butterfly. You can't break that cocoon and say, okay, you free, go. Change to a butterfly. They got to do it themselves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's the same type of energy.
It is. And that's what it is. It is all about the energy and, you know, the karma. It is all about that. And that's the real bitch. Karma is the real bitch. Respect her.
That's exactly what I said.
Respect her.
She's the real MVP, the real bitch of the situation.
That's right. Because mm-hmm. she demands her respect. And she's going to get her respect.
And she comes like a thief in the night, too, because that full circle effect, like you did something 10 years ago, it might come back 10 years later.
Yeah, it might come back 10 years later, 10 minutes later, but it does come back.
Yeah.
It does come back. It always does. So, mm-hmm. you know, and that's just my quirky way of thinking. And, you know, when I was a kid, I used to think, when I found out what nursing homes were,
mm-hmm.
and I would say to myself as a kid, maybe 10, 11 years old, why would anybody put their parents in a nursing home? That's a bad place for old people. As a kid, those were my beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, why would anybody do such a thing to their parents and then go and visit them? That's a terrible place. And at that time, I did not know the level of horror that sometimes elderly people succumb to,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the hands of unstable minds.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that as a child, but I knew that it was a bad place for old people. And why would their kids do that to them? That's what I understood as a child. You know what I understand as an adult?
What?
Is that, this is going to sound really bad, but I'm not a bad person. So I'm going to say it. sometimes I think as an adult, and this is not for everyone, I'm not going to put a blanket on it over everybody that's in a nursing home, but sometimes I think that I wonder what type of people were they when they were young.
Really?
Yeah. I think about that. You know.
Oh, I didn't think of, I forgot we had that conversation. What, because we were talking a long time ago, we said, dang, I wonder what happened to these people in their past for them to be now lying and suffering on their deathbed. What did they do?
And being abused.
And being abused.
Being physically under the care and watch of unstable-minded people.
Exactly.
And like I said, I don't want to put that blanket over every nursing home or over every elderly person that resides in a nursing home or over caretakers that take care of the elderly in nursing homes. I don't want to put a blanket over everybody. It's like saying, oh, all girls can cook, because that's not true.
No, heck no.
You know, or all guys know how to change a tire.
Right.
Because that's not true either. So I'm going to put a blanket over everybody.
But right.
I will say that as I've gotten older, an adult, that I have wondered what would the lives be? I wish someone would do a survey or an investigative report or something just to ask the people that are still cognitive or maybe family members, what type of person was your mom or your dad or your grandmother or your whoever's there you're going to see when they were young? You know, what did they do? What did they contribute to society or to the world or just in their within their family realms? What did they do to boost someone else up or, you know, or to help someone or a situation? What kind of person were they? You know, it would just be interesting to know.
Yeah, that I don't know what kind of surveys those are called, but that would be interesting to know, because I think like that too. I think outside the box. I often wonder how long it takes for social media to forget stuff. Because it's so many distractions in the world, including technology being one of them. If I tell you breaking news today, will you remember it 2 days from now? Probably not.
Yeah.
Just depending on what kind of person you are and how you pay attention to things.
Yeah.
So.
Absolutely.
I would like to see a survey on that too, and what you said. What kind of person was your parent or your friend or your whoever that's suffering right now in this life?
And trapped in their own minds.
Oh, that's the most terrible place to be.
Yeah.
It's the most terrible place to be. I think, why does a cage bird sing is the most appropriate example of being trapped in your mind.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's not a good place, especially for someone who cannot physically remove themselves.
Right, exactly.
You know, you're just lying there and, you know. So, yeah, that's what I think you got a lot of your sensitivity from having that connection to things that you cannot see, things that you can't necessarily touch, things that you can't necessarily hear audibly.
Right.
And I think this is, you know, your sensitivity to these things, because there are some that say, if I can't see it, if I can't touch it, if I can't hear it, then it's not real. And that's got to be one of the most irresponsible statements, one of the most, not the most, but one of the most irresponsible statements I think people can say. If I don't see it, if I can't feel it, if I can't touch it, you know, if I can't taste it, then it's not real, because there are so many things that you can't see, feel, or touch, or taste. And it's very real. The virus is very real. You can't, you know, you don't see it.
You
don't taste it.
Yeah, you see the damages of it, though.
But you can see the damages that, you know, that it caused. But if it's not causing damage to you, per se, but it's causing damage to an 80-year-old, a 70-year-old, well, you know, I'm 30-something years old, I'm 20-something years old. I ain't thinking about the virus.
Yeah, that's...
So,
yeah.
Yeah, so I think we're very connected. We are supposed to be very connected beings to the universe, but due to all the distraction, you mm-hmm. know, we don't necessarily fit that MO. So when you were a kid, you were very sensitive to those things. As you become an adult, you have a lot of distractions in your life.
Right.
You know, as we all do. And at some point, we all have to stop and say, wait a minute. I'm getting too far away from reality.
Mm-hmm.
Because reality is really universal, what's going on in the universe.
Speaking of it being universal, do you believe now at your age that you are connected with your inner child?
I have reconnected with her.
As of recently?
Well, it's been two reconnections. One was 5 years ago when your brother was in first grade and he was going to a private Christian school.
Mm-hmm.
And he came home one day and he says, I need to have a talk with you.
Hmm.
He was six. And I said, okay. And he said, no, this is really important. I need you to sit down. I'm thinking, oh my God, you know, I said, well, what, something happened in school?
Right.
And he goes, well, yeah. I said, what happened? Well, at the end of the day, we do this, everybody reads from their Bible, a scripture, and the teacher read, and she was telling us how beautiful, you know, like the manna was coming down from heaven, and when Moses struck the rock, and turned the serpent
mm-hmm.
became his cane became a serpent, and how Jesus turned the water into wine. And I said, okay. And he says, well, yeah, I'm having a problem with these stories. And I said, oh, well, what's your problem? He goes, well, first of all, how is manna falling from the sky and people are able to eat it?
Mm.
And before I could answer that, he went on to Moses striking the rock. I believe that's what the story is, that having the cane and it becoming a serpent.
Mm-hmm.
Serpent. And then Jesus turning the water into wine. So he went through each step and said, before I could answer any of them, how is this possible? And I said, oh, I'm stumbling. What? And he goes, Mom, let me ask you this. Do you believe those stories?
Wow.
And so that was my first reconnect with my inner child, because when I explained to him, when I was older than him, but still a child, I questioned those same stories.
Oh, okay.
And he said, well, what happened to you? And I thought about it and I said, I got grown. I didn't grow up. I just got grown.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes when we get grown, we have a tendency to lean towards what society says we should be. What society says we should listen to, what we should watch. And you begin to slowly but surely suppress things that you used to question. And that's what happened. I got grown. And he said to me, well, here's your problem. You've lost your imagination and you need to rediscover it as a six-year-old.
He said that?
Yeah.
Wow.
So I rediscovered my inner child then, and then it left again. And then I have recently had to rediscover her. And I said that to say it is an ongoing journey. You do not stop.
Isn't it? Mm-hmm. Just like the universe is ever expanding, so are we.
Yes.
And it makes sense.
Absolutely. The universe is constantly
expanding.
Yes, constantly in motion. Mm-hmm. It's always moving. Mm-hmm. It's like it's a chain of events. Mm-hmm. You know, so a chain reaction. So, yeah. So I'm rediscovering her once again. And don't ever make the mistake of thinking, okay, I got this lesson now. Let's move on to the next lesson. Because yeah. That next lesson might be an extension of the lesson that you thought you had.
That is so true. Mm-hmm. That is so true. There's levels to it, levels mm-hmm. to understanding, and levels to knowledge, of self-knowledge.
Yes.
Yes, I think we've all been here once or twice before. I don't know a being that's only been here one time. I don't know. Do you?
Well, it feels like something. I always equate it to deja vu.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you walk into a room or you sitting somewhere and you have this feeling that comes over you like, you know what, this feels awfully familiar. Mm-hmm. But I don't recall ever being here. But you know everything that's about to happen. And it happens. Mm-hmm. Just the way you know it's going to happen, but you know you've never been in this place before, this environment before, this state of mind before. And scientists still haven't been able to prove what that is all about, that deja vu. I think some have even said that maybe it's the feeling of being in from another dimension and you have somehow crossed over.
Yeah.
Parallel, so to speak, parallel dimension. And you have just kind of crossed over for that split second or those split moments. You know, it's like the universe maybe plays a little trick on you just to see, okay, how you're going to handle this, or, you know, or maybe it's not a trick at all. Maybe it's just something that the dimensions kind of bumped into each other and kind of threw each other off course for those seconds or those moments.
Yeah, I believe that sometimes you could be doing the exact same thing in another dimension, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. as a different person in a different situation, a different time right. period.
Right.
Because we connect, like, I think I was British. I think I was British in a different lifetime because I would say certain things and it almost feel like an echo of what was already said previously.
And you may have been, you just never know, because yeah. You know, they do have people that they can hypnotize people, and I think those work too, but you have to have a real hypnotist. Mm-hmm. You know, that they hypnotize people and they take them back as far as they can to another lifetime, and then they're able to find these people in history books that they said that they were.
Right. Like, I think I was born during Shakespeare's time. This is before the 13th century. And
wow.
Shakespeare was born actually like in the UK, like area, like the Britain area. So I'm like, oh, I do accents all the time from UK. And I write poetry, phenomenal poetry. So I'm like, maybe I was an ancestor of Shakespeare.
You never know.
Yeah.
One never knows.
That's so true. And then I have all these other different entities of accents within me. I'm like, how do I sound Russian or Ireland or Irish one day? Like, it's just so crazy. Yeah, I'm very worldly.
Mm-hmm. Worldly.
Worldly, yeah. mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But,
I don't know. Those are good analogies, though.
Isn't it, though? Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, where do you see the state of this country, literally this nation? Where do you see the state of this nation? I usually go further than this, but I want to do something different. Where do you see the state of this nation in a year from now? That's 12 months from now. So we're talking the end of next summer, 2021, August. Mm-hmm. What do you see?
By that time that the vaccine will be ramped up for the COVID-19.
Indeed.
I see that by the end of next summer that we'll be in a better state as far as the COVID-19 disease is concerned, because I think the reset button has already been set.
Exactly.
And it's going to depend on what people do.
That's right. Because we have what? Free will.
We have free will. And if we continue to say it's a hoax,
that's right.
It's not real, I think a lot of people would jeopardize themselves and loved ones, because they're, you know, people that have underlying conditions that don't even know they have underlying conditions because they have never been tested for anything. Or maybe they haven't had any symptoms of anything, which is maybe why they say Blacks and Latinos are hit the hardest.
Mm-hmm.
Because they may not know they're diabetic, but they may not know they have hypertension.
Mm-hmm.
They may not know they have, I don't know, whatever the other causes or complications with COVID-19. And, you know, as far as underlying conditions are. So I do see the vaccine being ramped up. As far as who's going to take the vaccine, that's another story. You know, a lot of people aren't willing to do that, especially people of color.
Right.
They're not willing to take a vaccine that's so readily available so quickly. So we'll see what happens with that. I see a lot of laws changing with the police brutality and these hate crimes, because there's been an explosion, not just in the U.S., but all over the world. All over the world. I mean, there isn't a country that didn't see what happened with George Floyd. We all saw it, not just in the U.S., but all over the world. And they took to the streets. They've never done this. This has never happened. I see a lot of laws changing in that area, because this generation, and I'm not talking about the looters and, you know, the people that are causing a lot of mayhem. I'm not talking about those people, because we're not agreeing with what they're doing.
Of course not. No.
But this generation, they seem to be like the generation that walked with Dr. King.
Yeah, I see that too. They're very courageous and strong and brave.
Yes, absolutely. Outside of the looting and the vandalism, the real protesters, the real protesters who stand for change, positive change, and who are going about it the correct way. This generation would be millennials or Gen Y, you know, Generation Y, those people that are born between, I guess, the early 80s, late 90s. I see these are the people that are really making a difference in this protest. So a year from now, I see the vaccines ramping up. I see laws changing, and I see people having to take this their health into their own hands more seriously.
Yes, I agree. And just to piggyback off what you said about the whole world pretty much being affected by what happened to George Floyd, the whole world took a part of that. The last time I saw the whole world involved, this just through my perspective, the whole world involved in something that affected everybody is with the presidency of Barack Obama. I saw the world cheer him on, the entire world, people in different countries, not just in the U.S.
Right.
And I thought that was magnificent.
Yeah.
And I think it's beautiful that people are taking charge because of what they saw happen to George Floyd, too. That was a lot of balls.
It definitely a lot of balls and strength and courage and
boldness,
fortitude and boldness, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Courageousness. They're out there fighting and protesting amid the pandemic. You know, they're not, and I'll tell you what else, this pandemic is not going to stop people from going out to vote.
No, it's definitely not going to. And that's another thing too, with the candidates, Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, I think.
Kamala Harris.
Those, I think those are two excellent candidates for.
She's a very strong candidate because he needs somebody strong.
He does.
On the campaign, when they were, everybody was, you know, all the candidates that were, you know, jockeying for the Democratic candidacy, she went toe-to-toe with Biden. I mean, she tore into him the first night that he came on to debate. She was the first one, and she lit into him like wildfire.
Mm-hmm.
And that's who he chose. And that's who he needed, somebody strong like her. Not somebody that's going to agree with everything that he said.
No, he didn't want a yes man. That's why he chose her.
Mm-hmm.
I think he was taken aback and impressed at the same time because she came after him full force.
Absolutely.
And there's nothing like a woman who stands in her power. I think it's very bold and sexy. I mean, you know. So, yeah.
Absolutely. And I think she's going to do well. Some people have tried to say she's not all black because I think one parent is
Indian and Jamaican.
Yeah. So, you know, I think the dad, I don't know which parent was which. But, you know.
I think her mom is Indian. And I think her dad is the Jamaican descent.
Okay. I don't know. I'd have to go into further detail. I really don't know. But, you know, I think she's a great pick. And I think she's going to make a difference because I like to see her as the first woman president.
I think that's great. Yeah.
Yeah, after this, Joe Biden is not going to run for a second term.
I don't think so either.
So he had to pick someone.
That can go further.
Yep. And she's the one.
Yeah, I think she's the one too. And you know, it's so funny because oftentimes we as Americans have often thought like, okay, when is it going to be time for a woman president? Mm-hmm. But you never know how the universe has things worked out. I think her running for vice president is the right thing to do first so we can get a taste of what she could do as president.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think she's going to be phenomenal.
I think so, too.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to the campaign. I'm looking forward to this election. And then again, I'm not because, you know, a lot of dirty tricks are going to be pulled out, just like the post office is asking for. I forget the exact number, but I know it's up in the trillions to be able to handle the mail-in ballots. And, you know, our president is not willing to give them the money that they need. So a lot of post office in different states have reported that their sorting machine that they have but these ballots have been removed from their offices. Mm. Ballot boxes have been removed where you were able to, if you couldn't mail your ballot at a post office, there were ballot boxes that you could, you know, different locations, you could drive up and put your ballot in the box. A lot of states have reported that those have been removed based on this administration, the Trump administration.
Yeah, it's the Trump administration kind of reminds me of the Bush administration.
Oh, there's no comparison.
You know what I mean, though. It's just a lot of trickery involved.
Oh, yeah.
God.
This trickery is way off the Richter scale.
Oh yeah, I believe you. I you know, making a tiny comparison and that's it.
Yeah.
Well, I would like to play a little game with you. It's called This or That. Okay, so let's get started.
Okay.
Summer or fall?
Summer.
Really? What?
Well, I would say the fall.
Right. Oh, I know why. Uh-huh. I already know why.
And that's why I said summer.
That's hitting the reset button on that ass, because yeah. You always say fall. Y'all like yep. to see the seasons change.
I do. I love to see the seasons change. But under these circumstances, I have to say summer.
Definitely. Okay. Free time or overtime?
Free time.
Okay. Okay. Bare face or makeup?
Bare face.
Exactly. Straight hair or curly hair? And we could have both.
Yes, I would say both.
But that wasn't the option.
I thought I could get away with that. I would say natural hair,
which can be straight too.
Well, for me, that would be curly,
right? Because you have like 4C hair,
whatever that means.
Tight curls.
Okay, well, that is exactly what I have. And if I straighten it out, yeah, it's beautiful when it's straightened out.
Yeah, of course.
But it's just like people. That's not his natural state.
Right.
You can only pretend for so long.
That's true.
And then your natural self will definitely come out.
That's true.
Definitely come out. So it's like your hair. You straighten it out. If it's naturally what you call 4C, then eventually it's going to, you know, repel back to its beautiful state of 4C.
That's true. Mm-hmm. Books or movies?
Oh, I'm so ashamed. I have so many books that I have not read. I order these books, Blood and Bones. I have that. And I rarely sit down and actually read the whole book through.
Okay.
So, and movies don't tell the whole story. So mm-hmm. I know it's this, okay, I gotta pick one. I'm gonna say movies. A movie will lead me to a book.
Yeah, it would.
That's what I'll say, a movie, because it will lead me to a book.
Documentaries or podcast?
Well, podcasts are relatively new for me.
Right.
So I'm going to say documentaries.
Great. I like that answer too. Mm-hmm. Romantic movies or comedy movies?
Oh, that really depends on how you feel. It really depends on how I feel. So mm-hmm. it depends on how I feel. But if I have to choose one, I'm going to say comedy.
Yeah, I like comedy too.
Yeah, if I had to choose one, I would say comedy, because sometimes romantic movies can lead to sadness.
Yeah, you're not in the mood for that.
Right.
Cats or dogs?
Cats.
Okay. Do you have any questions for me?
Yeah. Where do you see yourself in 5 years?
I see myself in a studio filled with an audience. Not too many people, because I This virus has really done a number on my brain.
Yeah. You better respect the virus.
Yeah. I would just have an intimate audience and be able to bring a fly in my guest from previous past interviews that I've done on the podcast. And it will be a syndicated show, and it's going to be broadcasted all over the world.
That's a beautiful vision, and that's a very obtainable vision. And I share that vision with you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Mom, for coming on today's show. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate you. Thank you.
You're welcome. And was this it inside question, inside joke? You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, and I'm not going to touch it.
Okay, that's good. Well, yeah, so thank you again for blessing the mic with me today. And it was a pleasure, as usual, to speak with you, and see you soon.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.